Hi, friends. Hey, Brother Mike, it's Sunday morning, 9 o'clock Mountain Time, 9 o'clock Arizona Time. And thank you so much for tuning in. I love meeting with you on Sundays. Real nice. I want to talk to you a little bit about revival today, but first I'll give you my contact information if you have any questions or any suggestions for future shows. Contact me on my email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. Our ministry line is 602-636-5800. We have two live services every week at the Arizona Deliverance Center in Phoenix. We're downtown. We're on 15th Avenue, just south of Osborn Road there. It's the red brick building. And we have two services every week live, and they are preaching, teaching, healing, and deliverance at both services. We do not shut down for holidays or for any other reason, actually. We have always been open, and we don't miss any services. We have our services on Thursday and Friday nights, so we don't conflict with local churches in the area who usually have services on Sundays or Wednesday nights. And we are not a church. We're a healing center, and we're not trying to develop or create a church. I'm not a pastor. I'm actually a counselor by trade. So we are not trying to take any people away from the churches. So if you're a pastor and you need somebody delivered from demons or soul wounds or needs to go through inner healing, hey, you can refer them to us, and we are not going to steal your person and try to steal your tithes or anything like that. We have generous people who care about this type of ministry online, and we have several other people who support the ministry, and we don't try to take people from other churches. Okay, we try to get people to come to the Deliverance Center for healing and deliverance, and then go back to their church and be a blessing to the people there and help lead them through deliverance and healing. So that's our main purpose. We're not trying to build a cult or an empire. And we are not centered around the cult of personality. I'm just the coordinator of the whole ministry. I am not the centerpiece of it. So the idea when you're serving God is you want to be a servant, not some kind of a weird, strange control freak who's running a TV preacher ministry or some insanity like that. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about revival today because it's spreading all over the place. Lots of things are happening spiritually in the United States. Back in 2008 or 7, something like that, I had a strange thought come over me about deliverance, and that someday there would be a deliverance revival, and that deliverance would be the flavor of the month, so to speak. And I did a radio program on it. I think I might have done a couple. I've been on the radio here locally on 1010 AM Christian radio for over 20 years. I started at KPXQ radio when I initially started the first 2 years. And this exact thing has happened. There is a major deliverance revival sweeping across America. You can catch all these deliverance people on YouTube. Now there's a Holy Ghost revival starting to break out. And it broke out, as you know, at Asbury College in Kentucky, and it spread to Lee University in Tennessee. And I checked it out on YouTube and did some research with it. It appears to be legit. It appears to be a legitimate move of the Holy Ghost, and I'll tell you why. If you notice in this revival, it's a lot of love and a lot of praise going on at these services, okay? And thirdly, it's starting to pick up lots of criticism from religious people, from church people, from people who don't know anything about the moving of the Spirit, but they do know how to criticize it. I watched a YouTube video just to give you an example of a Baptist minister. This was about 6 days, 7 days after the revival broke out at Asbury. He did a short video on why this thing was of the devil. And he said he could tell it was of the devil because they didn't believe in King James only. And then secondly, the guy said that the revival had to be of the devil because they had women there who were giving testimonies and leading in worship and so on. So you can't have women in charge of anything. This guy was obviously a Baptist minister and so on. And so that was a big red flag for me that the revival was legitimate because it draws enormous criticism. The next thing that's going to happen is on these revivals is that the devil's going to send in infiltrators. And that principally, there's going to be two of them, two types that will come in on this revival. All you got to do is keep watching it. You'll see this is exactly what's going to happen. The thing's only been going like 2 weeks now. Number one, the devil will start sending in people who are loaded with demons. And there's going to be deliverance starting up at these revivals. People are going to be getting set free from demons. But in that process, they will start manifesting demons during the service. And the devil will use that to criticize the revival and make a mockery out of it. And he'll use it to scare people. The reason that churches got rid of deliverance 70 or 80 years ago was because of fear and confusion. People look at demons and they go, hey, I don't want anything to do with that. That's confusing me and it scares me. And I understand if you don't have someone who is experienced in deliverance and understands how it works, you're going to be the type of person that's going to be confused or scared about it. That's human nature. And the devil knows how to do it. I overcame a little bit of it at the Arizona Deliverance Center and years ago at the House of Healing. When God showed me during a prayer session I was having at Burger King, a thought popped into my head to turn down the lights because people were reluctant to go through deliverance if they had this sense that somebody was staring at them or that they were being watched. And when we started putting all our services on YouTube, I realized then that I needed to give the people that were going through deliverance some visual privacy. And so instead of using the person as a kind of a carnival act while they were manifesting, I did the best I could to kind of hide it from the general public and hide it during the services so people would not feel so insecure or, you know, wouldn't feel as if somebody was looking at them and judging them or thinking negative feelings or thoughts about them. And it worked. God showed me that worked. We've had enormous fruit in addition to our normal deliverances when I turned down the lights during the altar call so that the YouTube people couldn't actually see what was going on. Okay. We're not trying to hide anything. I was doing it because I was concerned about the emotional welfare of the people coming for help. Okay. Let's go to the deliverance revival that's going on now. I've touched on this earlier in a prior podcast. Don't get involved in any of these deliverance revivals or deliverance ministers on YouTube who emphasize manifestations. I do my best to minimize manifestations. All I care about is getting the spirit out of the person's body or their brain so that they can be physically healed and be mentally restored. That's all I care about. I don't have another interest in the world. And if you focus on manifestations, the devil's going to use manifestations against you. He's going to turn it into a dog and pony show or some kind of a weird state fair carnival. And he's going to turn your service into a funhouse mirror. And it's going to go bad. And that's what they're doing on these YouTube deliverance ministers. They're all showing all these spectacular manifestations. Number two, every deliverance ministry has to be centered around repentance, because repentance brings in the manifestation of the Spirit and the love of God. Repentance is the key to going through deliverance. If the person is not repentant, if they have no godly sorrow for their sin, the probability of that person getting free is going to be very low. You will get some demons out of them because of the general anointing in the service, but the controllers will take a dive inside and they will go dormant. They'll hide. And they're legally allowed to do that because you, as a minister, did not lead that person through repentance. And it normally starts in the beginning at unforgiveness, at ought. Ought and unforgiveness are different. And most churches do not teach that, and that's why they can't get their people set free. Going through unforgiveness and repenting of it is a state of the mind and a portion of your character in your conscience. Ought is the yucky, negative, crappy feeling you still have for someone in your past that either hurt you or somebody that you love or somebody you cared for, your kids, your spouse, what have you. Ought is that feeling you have for that person. That must be removed, and that's part of the Holy Spirit's great work, but you must first repent of it. You haven't talked to your sister in 20 years. You got to repent of that and make an attempt to fix that relationship. Send them an email apologizing to them or give them a call or something, whatever you got to do to get that ought for your sister or your dad or your whoever out of your system. And the Holy Spirit will remove it if you will repent. Secondly, repentance is essential for a revival. Back in the 1700s, Jonathan Edwards and the rest of the crew in the 1800s, Finney and all these guys, great superstar preachers, they preached repentance. And the Holy Spirit rushed in and started an outpouring. Repentance is the key. And if you're involved in a megachurch, best example, you know, Hillsong, Acts 29, Mars Hills, these different gigantic megachurch dinosaurs sweeping through the country. Here in Phoenix, Maricopa County, for example, Hillsong has invaded this area. They bought up half a dozen churches. And that is not a repentance-based system. That's a glory-based, feel-good-based, singing-based, praise-based system. And if you don't have repentance and make that the centerpiece of your revival or your deliverances, the demons will just simply run scandals through your system. That's what you've got in Hillsong. Lust scandals, sex scandals, affairs, money scandals. All these things are going to happen in your system if you do not make repentance the centerpiece of your system of restoration to God. You cannot soft soak it. During the Super Bowl, Jesus gets us. What they're doing there is they're lowering the standards for God by making Jesus your buddy, your friend. He gets you. That system is not going to work. It's been tried a million times in the past, trying to make Jesus fan friendly. They want to turn you in a fan of Jesus. And the theory behind it is, if we get him to first kind of accept Jesus and not feel any condemnation about his teachings, then later on, possibly something will trigger in their spirit man and they will become a dedicated, sold out disciple of Christ. Okay. And I must admit, the grace of God is so powerful that in a very small percent of cases, less than 1%. It happens. It does happen. But generally speaking, that system is not going to work. That will not work. You cannot lower the standards of the gospel and expect the Holy Ghost to move. Let's go to Ashbury College now. This was, what, 2 weeks ago it started? Something like that? A guy gets up out of nowhere, stands up in the front of the chapel service. They have three chapel services every week there at Ashbury. It's a Methodist university. The Methodists founded it, okay? And this guy stands up and starts confessing his sins. Well, that is essential for a revival, either an individual one or a group one or a mass revival. That is essential. Paul said, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And part of that cleansing is the removal of spirits that the person collected over the years, living in sin and serving Satan and serving themselves. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life are door openers for spirits to enter the body and cause a sickness, enter the mind and cause a mental illness. That's how the system works in the spirit world. And again, the key to revival is what John the Baptist preached. John the Baptist was the greatest preacher that ever lived. And his message to the people of Israel was a repentance-based system. In fact, his baptism was called the baptism of repentance. When Jesus won round one with the devil in the wilderness, the Bible says he came back in the power of the Spirit and preached, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Repentance is the main theme of you experiencing the glorious love of God and the anointing and the giftings and finding your destiny. That's how this thing works. All right? So let's flip over to the revival side at Ashbury. Again, I mentioned that it appears to be legitimate from my research. And I think it's proving legitimate because the demons are now sending in ministers to try to hijack the revival under the guise of they want to help the revival. And the first group of ministers that's going to come in are the prophetics. The prophetics are going to rush in because they see an opportunity for great spiritual manifestations. Okay? The prophetics are going to move in. The TV preachers are going to move in. There's enormous amount of money to be made off these revivals, selling tapes, selling flash drives, selling everything, promoting programs, promoting services. They're going to get invaded by religious people. Secondly, they're going to get severely criticized by other religious people. Okay? And that's exactly what happened here in Acts chapter 2. Real quickly, it came to pass in the last days, says the Lord, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Now, this word here, pour out, is the one I like for a revival. It's the Greek word ekeo, and it means like I would pour liquid out of a pitcher, right? I poured out some milk in a bowl and had a bowl of cereal this morning. I had an ekeo. I poured it out. Well, that's poured out at different levels. You can pour a little bit out, a little more, a lot out, all of it. You can pour all kinds out of it. So that means that if you have an altar call or you have a private counseling session and that person gets delivered from demons and healed of soul wounds, that is an outpouring. But it's an outpouring for one person. Okay, now what they're experiencing in Ashbury, this thing's, by the way, is going to spread to a lot of other universities and colleges. And I think what's happening here behind the scenes, the Holy Ghost saw the destruction of our young people in America based on clinical depression, based on drug usage, based on TikTok, based on social media, based on Facebook, all these horrible things that are stealing the minds of our young people, I think the Holy Ghost said, hey, I'm not going to sit here and do nothing. I'm going to fight back. And I think that's what he's doing. He's reaching out to the young people at these universities where they're being brainwashed with total insanity of agnosticism and atheism. And the Spirit of God is fighting back. And you can tell that the revival is legitimate because it's based on praise and love. If you go into these services, you'll actually feel the presence of the Holy Ghost, and it's a presence of love. It's a presence of conviction of sin. Conviction is your best friend, even though initially it feels a little uncomfortable. But conviction is one of the greatest blessings God ever gave a human being, because God is telling the person, hey, I'm watching you and I care about you, and I want you to make a couple of corrections here. That's love. A parent would do that for their child that they love. Your Heavenly Father is doing it for you. You are His child whom He loves. Conviction is the greatest blessing you'll ever lay your eyes on. It does hurt initially. Yes, I've been convicted numerous times over the years about things I've done and things I've said. It felt uncomfortable in the beginning, but if you repent, repentance, boom, grace and mercy restores you, and you can receive the presence of the Holy Ghost. It says here, the Lord said, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your young men, they will see visions, and your old men, they will dream dreams. On my servants and on my handmaids, I will pour out my Spirit, saith the Lord. And there it is. That's what's happening here. It's an akeo, an outpouring, a pouring of the Spirit. This in a mass sense. Okay? But you must remember what's coming so that you're prepared for it. This is what's going to happen with these revivals. They're going to spread. Okay? Ashbury got hit with a revival during the Jesus People movement of the 1970s. The Holy Ghost hit that college in 1970, and something similar to what's happening now happened then. The Jesus People revival spread all over the country in different pockets, and a lot of great preachers came out of the Jesus movement back in the 70s, Mario Murillo being probably the most powerful one. And you can see in Acts, it says, Peter said to the crowd, he said, repent and be converted. Why? So your sins may be blotted out, so the times of refreshing will come from the presence of the Lord. So you see, the initial move that brings the love of God in is repentance. And when that kid stood up at Ashbury, he was repenting, and he was doing what I call a proxy prayer, and he didn't even know it. He was repenting for himself, but dozens of other students heard him say that, and they realized they needed to repent. It was an amazing move of God. And then suddenly, a few minutes later, the outpouring came in, and it started. It started. I've been unsuccessfully, to this point, trying to do the same thing Friday nights at 6:45. I have a GLOSA group, a group of people that meets at the Deliverance Center just before my teaching. The teaching starts at 7. And I have this group singing in tongues and praying in tongues, because that blessing of speaking and praying in tongues draws in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Okay. And I encourage people all the time to come to that group and grow spiritually while you're using your, what I call the glosa gift. And that's what I'm trying to do on Friday nights. I'm trying to trigger the moving of the Spirit at the Deliverance Center. Now, this Greek word, here's an interesting one. The word revival, okay, it's in Romans chapter 14. It's only used twice in the New Testament, believe it or not. The word revival, it's only used twice, and it's only in Romans and only by Paul. It's the Greek word anaazo, It means to be revived from the dead. To be revived from the dead. So the preachers took that word, revived, turned it into revival, and they used it to describe an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. It's in Romans 14, verse 9. Okay? And that's basically what it is. A revival is an outpouring of the Spirit in a small measure or a larger one or a gigantic one, whatever it is. And so technically, every service at the Deliverance Center is a revival, so to speak, because at the altar call, people are getting healed and delivered from demons in real time on YouTube, and you can actually kind of see part of it and hear part of it going on. You can actually see a revival. It's actually an outpouring on a much smaller scale than Ashbury. But the Ashbury revival is going to get hit and hit hard. As I told you, the prophetics are coming in, the TV preachers will come in, the secular news media will come in, and the devil does all these things because he's trying to create confusion. If he can create confusion, consternation will follow. It always does. Okay? Now let's go back in time then. Hundreds of years ago, right? The Welsh revival was unbelievable. It was unbelievable. Outpouring of the Spirit. Okay? Let's not use the word revival. I don't like to use it. It was a massive outpouring of the Holy Ghost and His presence. You see, there's a couple of different types of presence, correct? There's omnipresence, which is what the Holy Spirit has. He's everywhere, all over the place at the same time, okay? King David said, if I go to the heights of heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. What he was describing there was the omnipresence of God. Okay, the omnipresence of God isn't going to do us any good. It never has. The manifest presence of God is what you're looking for, and that is what triggers an outpouring of the Holy Spirit, sometimes small, sometimes huge. It depends on the circumstances of the case. And in this case, it's going to be huge and spread to a number of other educational institutions. Academia is going to be getting hit now, Holy Ghost style, and they're going to have to take it right square in the face. And that's the way I like it. I love it when the Holy Ghost kicks the devil's face in. Nothing better than that. Love, sit there and watch it. Best thing in the world to watch. You wouldn't believe it. I have the incredible privilege of seeing it every week of my life. It's a great honor and privilege to see the Spirit of God kick the devil's face in. That's my number one hobby in life. I hope it soon becomes yours. They're going to get attacked. The Welsh revival got attacked. And what happens is when a outpouring breaks out, in the kingdom of darkness, alarm bells go off, and the demons and the familiar spirits and the fallen angels, what have you, they rush to the revival, and they send Kundalini spirits into these revivals. Kundalini spirits are Holy Spirit fakers. They impersonate the Holy Ghost and the things that He does. And they give people manifestations that feel good in their body and in their mind. They give them kind of ecstasy in their mind and nice feelings and comfort in their body. But it's all fake. It's all based on the human mind and the human soul. An outpouring of the Holy Spirit is spirit man triggered. It's spirit man triggered, not soul based, not human intellectually based. So what happened in the Welsh revival, a massive outpouring of the Spirit occurred, spreading to numerous other countries, America being one of them. It got over to Azusa Street. and unbelievable things happened. Unbelievable things happened. What happened next? Yeah, the demons raced in. The people there didn't understand familiar spirits. The familiar spirits wrecked the revival, and they gave the minister running that revival, Evan Roberts, a nervous breakdown. And within 1 year, the revival was wiped out. Within 1 year. It happened again at Azusa Street. I mean, it was the biggest thing that ever hit America, Azusa Street. Seymour started the revival down there. He was a loving, broken, humble human being. The guy was fantastic. Bill Seymour. He was great. What happened then? That exact same thing happens. The familiar spirits raced in. The Kundalini demons raced in. Massive criticism happened. They were attacked from every quarter. And Bill Seymour was sitting there up a front by the podium. And there was almost nobody there within a year or so. It was all over. It was gone. Why does that happen? This is a war. This is a war for the souls of men. Most people die and go to hell. And the Holy Ghost doesn't like that. He doesn't approve of it. Your Heavenly Father doesn't approve of it. The Lord Jesus died to prevent it. This is a war. And most churches don't see it like that. All these revivals that start up, they don't have the spiritual understanding, the knowledge, or the experience to ward off these attacks. It's going to happen at Ashbury and Lee and all these other universities. This thing's going to go super strong for a while, and then the devil is going to infiltrate it. He sends in infiltrators to mop it up. Lakeland. Yep, the thing just took off like crazy. Outpouring, huge. What happened next? Yep, all Todd Bentley's demons manifested, blew the whole thing up. A year or so. That's what happened. Toronto, Canada, the Toronto blessing. What was that, 93, 92, 93, 94, something like that? Same thing happened. Huge outpouring, and the people running the revival in Canada, good people. Randy Clark, fabulous man of God, loving man of God. The Arnault family, oh, they love the Lord. Good pastors, good people. Didn't have any understanding of spiritual warfare. Didn't understand what I just explained to you. These Kundalini demons are assassins. And they're sent in to wipe out the revival. And they became infiltrators into the Toronto blessing. And to this day, that whole movement is infected with familiar spirits. Kundalini demons, weird manifestations. They gave everything to people to fool everybody. And they fooled people left and right. Oh, there's some gold dust. Oh, there's some gems over there. Oh, my goodness. Oh. Now it's glory clouds. Oh, there's a glory cloud in the room. Oh, boy. These are Kundalini spirits faking everybody out. It's absolutely horrible. Oh, there's somebody over there praising the Lord. Here's somebody over there barking like a dog. They're infiltrators. They infiltrate the system. And the devil fears a huge outpouring. He panics. Because he knows the Holy Ghost can do. Nothing's out of his range. Nothing's too hard for him. The only person demons truly fear is the Spirit of the Lord. They're actually afraid of him. They're scared of him. Jesus had the full anointing of the Spirit without measure. Nobody's ever had it before or since. When Jesus confronted a spirit in the New Testament, they start screaming. It happened in Mark chapter 1. Some guy sitting on the front row listened to the teaching, and then bang, this demon couldn't take it anymore, and he started screaming. He started to have an epileptic seizure. I mean, this thing pitched a fit. Why? They're scared. They're scared. The maniac of Gadara, Mark 5. The two maniacs of Gergesenus, Matthew 8. Man, they were scared. The demons were scared. They were trying to negotiate a deal with Jesus. Hey, no, you know, don't send us to the abysses or the abyss. Send us over to these stinking pigs over here. Demons fear the moving of the Spirit. They don't fear anybody else. They don't fear you. They don't fear me. Nothing. They are petrified when the manifest presence of the Holy Ghost shows up, not the omnipresence. Everyone has that. That's not going to do you any good. The manifest presence of the Holy Spirit brings in all the miracles of the living Christ. That's how it works. And repentance brings in the moving of the Spirit, the love of God, and the power of the Holy Ghost. That is the first thing that has to be done. And if you're going to get involved with the deliverance revival, or you're going to get involved with this new Holy Ghost revival, that's great. I hope you do. But you've got to remember that the Word of God puts parameters on these things. And if it's not a confession of sin and a repentance revival or deliverance revival, you better red flag it, because Kundalini spirits are going to get in. The devil's going to send in infiltrators, and they're going to wipe the revival out. Welsh revival, wiped out. Azusa Street, wiped out. Lakeland, wiped out. Pensacola was better than Toronto Blessing by far, okay? That revival was much more directed toward repentance and people getting converted so their sins could be blotted out. So the times of refreshing should come from the presence of the Lord. And that revival lasted, what was it, 5 years, 6 years, something like that. And the reason for that is the Toronto revival was not a repentance-based system. It was a Holy Ghost manifestations, feel good, hallelujah, glory zone revival. Okay, it wasn't a repentance-based revival. The Pensacola one, there were infiltrators in it. There was Kundalini in it, but nothing to the level of the Toronto experience. Pensacola was far superior revival to the Toronto one. They had a hardcore preacher there named Steve Hill. He was a repentance-oriented evangelist, and that's why that one lasted so long. And that's why it went so well. And so all these revivals throughout history, the devil treats them all the same. He sends in infiltrators, imposters, impersonators, critics, condemners, criticizers. And that's exactly what's going to happen to this revival. If they can keep the prophetic ministers out and keep out these TV preachers out of these outpouring settings like Ashbury or Lee or the other ones it's spreading to now, if they can do that, the revival will last longer. But if the infiltrators come in, the Kundalini spirit ministers come in, and if they listen to all their critics, the Baptists, the Lutherans, all these people criticizing the revival, if they listen to that, this thing's going to, you know, have a short shelf life. Okay, but the same system of the revival of an outpouring can be done in your life anytime you choose. It's your choice. That kid at Ashbury stood up and made that confession, and he repented in front of all those people because he had free will and he was desperate for God. And if you look through the New Testament, these individual outpourings were all triggered by desperation for God. The woman with the issue of blood, blind Bartimaeus, the two blind men, the dying leper. They were all desperate to get to God. Okay, that's a polar opposite of a church service. Okay, there's no desperation to get to God at a church service. that's just a routine thing where you go in and have a Bible study, you get a good word, sing a few songs, hallelujah, have an offering, somebody gives a schedule, future activities, announcements, then you go home and, you know, you hit Peter Piper Pizza, you hit Arby's, you run over to Wendy's. It's just like another thing. That is not going to trigger an outpouring. That's just simply a religious maintenance system that does not work. Okay? So you can have an outpouring as big as you decide it could be. You can make it and you can do it. And God's calling you to do it. But it's all based on your free will. God always moves based on people's free will. And so right now, as I'm speaking to you, there are people flying into Kentucky to go see this thing, because what people really want in life, and they don't even know it, but deep down inside in their spirit man, built in at the time of their conception and at their birth, there's an urge, a need in people to find God. They know he exists somehow. They know he's there somehow. And deep inside, they're built like that. I want to be with my Heavenly Father. That's the way all human beings are. They're born with it. It's innate in your spirit man, right in here in your spirit man. Okay, and once the Holy Ghost breaks out somewhere, people will fly in from everywhere to get to him. Because the Holy Spirit, as you know, brings all the blessings of the living Christ. He has, and he is the only person that has, 100% of the power of the blood of Christ, 100% of the healing power of the broken body of Christ. The Holy Spirit is the administrator of the estate of the Lord Jesus Christ that was given to him by God the Father. Jesus said, everything that Father has is mine. That's a lot, right? Right. The web telescope now is unbelievable, isn't it? There are galaxies everywhere in the universe. Everything Father has, Jesus said, is mine. And John 14, 15, 16, he explained, I'm going to administer my estate through the executor of my estate, the Holy Ghost. And so when people see an outpouring or a revival somewhere, they will travel and go anywhere, anyhow, at any expense, just to get to him. Once he shows up, it's game on. And the devil is going to get another face kicking. And there's nothing he can do about it. So what does he do? The devil's a counterpuncher, and he's very good at it. I boxed myself when I was young, off and on for 10 years. I was an amateur boxer. I started when I was a welterweight in eighth grade, and I retired after a fight in Kansas City in 1980. But my favorite fighter, my idol when I was young, was a guy named Jerry Quarry. He was a fighter from Bellflower, California, and I kind of grew up in Anaheim, so I really liked him. He had a brother named Mike Quarry, and Jerry Quarry was a spectacular fighter, but he was a counterpuncher, and he would literally wait for you to fire a shot, and he was already planning the counterpunch after you let go. He was a counterpuncher. He was the best in the business at it. And that's exactly what the devil is. He can't stop an outpouring. He can't stop you from repenting. He can't stop you from confessing your sins. He can't stop that. You got free will, and you can use it whenever you decide to use it. You are in charge of your mind. You are in charge of your body, and you can do what you want to do with your mind and with your body, period. He can't stop it. But once the Holy Ghost manifests, the manifest presence of God, the Greek word is prosopon, the manifest presence of God, not the omnipresence. That's, everybody has that, and it doesn't do anybody any good. But the manifest presence of God, the Holy Ghost, based on confession and repentance, that can't be stopped. The devil cannot stop that. But what he does is he's a counterpuncher, like Jerry Quarry used to be. He sees the revival go, and he sends in infiltrators. He sends in investigators. He sends in sub rosa, surveillance teams. He sends in kundalini spirits to impersonate the moving of the Holy Ghost. Kundalini spirits are Holy Spirit fakers, and they impersonate the moving of the Spirit of God. They watch what he does, and then they try to imitate it, right? I've been in several kundalini services over the years, watching and taking notes and watching how these demons work. It's really quite remarkable. They're very intelligent, very aggressive. And you'll sit in a kundalini service, and you'll see somebody rocking back and forth in the pew or their chair. Oh, they're going like this. They can't stop. And they're making noises, ho, and ho, and they're going back and forth like that. Well, that's a sign for you and I that that spirit manifesting in there has to be cast out. But to a kundalini service, or kind of like they had at the Toronto Blessing, that's actually a manifestation of God. So that's not to be stopped. You let that go. Well, you're going to get total deception in your service, and your revival is going to end up destroyed if you let those demons continue to manifest. Friday night, I told a story of a friend of mine that I went to a service in North Phoenix, and this minister that was there had tremendous demonic power. It was absolutely amazing. At the altar call, I mean, from one end of the church to the other, people were lined up on the floor, and my friend, who I had known for years, and I knew that she was a beautiful woman of God, very strong person, powerful faith, she was on the floor snorting like a pig. My eyeballs popped out. She was snorting like a pig. I saw her and heard her. Well, those are kundalini spirits. She didn't know she had them. They're familiar spirits. They're mind trickers. They're Holy Ghost imitators. And while you're laying on the ground snorting like a pig, it feels good. They give you physical sensations. They give you euphoria. They give you a sense of, wow, this feels good. This must be the Holy Spirit. If it's good, it has to be the Holy Spirit. They're imitators. They're fakers. It's going to happen in Ashbury. It's going to happen at Lee University. It's going to happen. Watch this thing go. And people who don't learn from history, they're doomed to what? Yeah, they're going to repeat it. They're going to repeat it. Okay? And, you know, I think just yesterday, a bunch of news media wanted to go in and do a reporting on it. And the people at the revival said, God love them. They said, hey, don't come here. But look, the devil will keep sending in. You'll get prophetics coming in. Okay. They'll want to come in and, you know, help the revival. And what they're actually doing is spreading familiar spirits so that the revival is destroyed, a la the Welsh revival, Azusa Street, Lakeland. They all eventually kaboom because of these sub rosa instigators and infiltrators. So I recommend you keep praying for them, but more importantly, I recommend that you have your own outpouring and then you spread it to dozens of other people. See? Because you're in charge, right? Remember that cartoon, Charles in Charge? Yeah, no, you're in charge. See? God will honor your free will, your prayers, and your love, and he will send you an outpouring, and you will then spread it to others. Yeah, and you start your own Ashbury revival. How about that? How about that? How about doing that? Why not? What's stopping you? Well, your own free will stopping you. Yeah. Every Friday night at 6:45, I'm so grateful for the people that come to sing and sing in tongues at the Deliverance Center. But I'm still praying, hey, that's not enough. I need 10 more. And then I'm going to need 10 more. And at some point, the manifest presence, precipice of the Spirit will drop. And then you're off and running to a period of time in your life that you will never forget. Nobody who ever attended any of the revivals in the beginning when the Spirit of God was poured out ever forgot it. They never, it's a life-changing, life-remembering revival. Okay, and what was that, 2006, I think it was. No, 2000 and, no, strike that. It was 1997, I believe. I went to the Pensacola revival myself to check it out. And I remember every day I was there. I remember everything. It was, you know, it was quite remarkable. Yeah, there was some strange manifestations going on. But at that time, I had not been delivered from demons. And I didn't really know what was going on. So I didn't have any very good discernment back then. I didn't understand how the spirit world works back then, like I do now. But the revival was really spectacular. I saw the Holy Ghost moving. Whew, it was amazing. And that's the only thing I've ever really been interested in. God's word and the moving of the Spirit. Those two things. Those are my favorite things. And I like that. How about you? Yeah. You want a word today? Okay. God wants to send you an outpouring on a personal basis. How do I know this? I have seen it in my own ministry numerous times. Okay. I set the ministry up to operate in a certain way. What I do is I downplay myself and I promote and boost up others. So I have over the years seen several people go into the ministry on their own and develop their own ministries. And I have stepped back and had nothing to do with any of it. I just promoted them and encouraged them to do that. I have had four or five people come through Deliverance in our ministry who have written books on deliverance. They have become evangelists. And that's the purpose of it. Okay, you don't want to try to control people. You don't want to constantly run their show. You want to boost people up, help them get their own ministry going, their own anointing, their own giftings. That's your goal. That's your goal. And the people that I have put on the ministry staff that have been trained over the years, they now do deliverance in all kinds of different settings, at their house, at work, what have you, not just at the Arizona Deliverance Center. And that's the purpose of the gospel. You want a outpouring to strike, and then you want it to spread. That's your goal. And I'll be in Chula Vista on March 11th, Chula Vista, California. If you live in the San Diego area, I hope you join me. There's going to be an outpouring, so to speak, a revival in that service. You're going to see people getting delivered from demons in that service like you wouldn't believe. I mean, dozens of people are going to get delivered from demons that night. It's going to be amazing. Several people are going to be healed. You can watch it actually happen. But what's the point there? You lay out the red carpet for the Holy Ghost. You focus on confession and repentance. And just like Peter said, just like he said, it works exactly like he said. Repent and be converted that your sins may be blotted out. So the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and he will send you Jesus. How about that? Pretty good, huh? Yeah, A, it works. I'll see you next time.